This video is sponsored by Scalar. If you had billions of dollars at your disposal to invest in energy tech, what would you choose? Maybe some breakthrough solar tech that's more efficient? How about some grid-scale energy storage solutions? Well, if you're anything like Bill Gates, you'd be investing in a potential breakthrough type of nuclear reactor called the Traveling Wave Reactor. While we all hope and dream of a world run on wind, sunshine, and batteries, many experts see nuclear energy as a necessary stopgap measure while other energy tech catches up. But Ricky, what about all the dangers like leaks and meltdowns and three-eyed fish, you say? Well, if Gates' Traveling Wave Reactor is all it's cracked up to be, we may finally see a nuclear option with all the benefits and none of the dangers, or at least far fewer. While other types of clean renewable energy production have made some major headway in the last few decades, nuclear energy still reigns supreme when it comes to energy density, reliability, and carbon emissions. But despite its many advantages, many have difficulties getting past nuclear energy's, shall we say, failures. Headline-grabbing nuclear disasters like Fukushima, Three Mile Island, stockpiles of dangerously radioactive waste, the proliferation of nuclear weapons, all this casts a major shadow on nuclear energy's reputation. For some, the idea of safe, clean, and affordable source of nuclear energy is nothing more than science fiction. But that may all soon change as Terrapower, a company founded by none other than Bill Gates, plans to unveil their Traveling Wave Reactor in Kemmerer, Wyoming. So what exactly is a traveling wave reactor? Maybe it's because I live in San Diego, but to me, a traveling wave reactor sounds like someone driving around in a VW bus looking for some epic surf. The name comes from how the machine works. As the company's founder describes it, the reactor is essentially a giant uranium candlestick that undergoes fission from one end to the other. The process stays confined to a boundary zone that slowly advances over time. An overhead crane maintains the reaction within the ringed portion of the core by moving pins in and out of the reaction zone, sort of like a claw machine at an arcade, only nuclear. The technology that TerraPower builds on actually came from around the middle of the 20th century. Following World War II, both the US and Soviet Union began toying with the idea that nuclear energy is used outside of the theater of war. Imagine that. In 1958, during the Second International Conference of Peaceful Uses of Atomic Energy, yes, that's actually a thing, held in Geneva, astrophysicist Savelli Feinberg envisioned the concept of a fission reactor that could produce its own fuel, what became known as breed and burn reactors. The earliest iterations of the idea featured a slowly advancing wave of fission through a fuel source, like a big cigar that takes decades to burn through. Unfortunately, at the time, uranium was plentiful and other types of reactors were cheaper to build and operate, and the concern over nuclear waste wouldn't truly arise for another few decades. So Feinberg's design was shelved. That is, until 2006, when astrophysicist Lowell Wood became an advisor for TerraPower's parent company. There, Wood dusted off Feinberg's nearly 50-year-old concept. Wood suggested the Traveling Wave Reactor, or TWR, a subtype of the breed-and-burn design. So how exactly does the reactor work, and what sets it apart from other types of reactors? According to the company, TerraPower's TWR is designed to be a liquid, sodium-cooled fast reactor. While other reactors use water to transfer heat from the reactor core to the steam turbines, molten salt can do a better job moving more heat out of the core while also being less corrosive to the metal pipes. Now that one's interesting. Molten salt, less corrosive. All right, if you say so. Plus, the TWR doesn't use the typical steam turbine generator seen in most of today's reactors. Instead of simply using the core's intense heat to boil water and drive the turbines directly, TerraPower's TWR uses a more sophisticated system, where the heat gets absorbed by a looping stream of liquid sodium, which then leaves the reactor core and boils the water to drive the steam engine. Liquid sodium can absorb more heat than water, meaning less pressure buildup inside the reactor, reducing the risk of explosion. This cooling system also doesn't require an outside energy source to operate, making them less vulnerable during an emergency shutdown. A tsunami that shut down the diesel generator running the backup cooling system was a major contributor to the Fukushima disaster in 2011. The small change could make TerraPower's TWR inherently safer than other types of nuclear reactors. But perhaps the biggest headline for traveling wave reactors is that they not only consume, but produce their own fuel. How is that possible? Well, let's start by looking at how today's typical reactors work. Before we get back to the show, I wanted to share something about myself and talk about our sponsor this week, Scalar. When I think about all my decisions that led to becoming a full-time creator on YouTube, learning how to code tops that list. Getting a software job doubled and tripled my salary, allowed me to buy a house, save up enough money to take a leap of faith and do YouTube full time. When it comes to learning, one size doesn't fit all. Scalar is an online accelerator program to enhance and level up your coding skills. Their carefully curated computer science courses, mentorship, interview hacks, referrals, and more are academically comprehensive and presented by engaging industry leaders. Put simply, Scalar is the go-to place to learn more about coding and open up future doors for a new career. You've probably noticed seemingly everything today, even this water filter, is smart and has an app. The demand for software engineers is massive and growing, placing you at the heart of a great career for decades to come. Check out Scalar using our link in the description and start your journey to a new career today. Huge thanks to Scalar and you for supporting the show. Fission reactors typically utilize enriched uranium, which has a high concentration of a particular isotope, U-235, as well as a more predictable counterpart, U-38. We covered this in our recent video on thorium reactors, which you can check out here. In a typical reactor, when a neutron hits a uranium-235 atom, the atom splits into barium and krypton isotopes. Yes, like Superman's home planet. Imagine a ping pong ball shot of an incredibly high-speed blast through a solid paddle. This process can start a chain reaction as more particles are colliding with more atoms until the reaction reaches critical mass, where the reaction becomes self-sustaining. The process generates a huge amount of heat and power, but the one major downside is that once the uranium core is depleted, finding a safe storage is a major problem. Radioactive waste can remain dangerously radioactive for tens of thousands of years. TWRs, on the other hand, begin with depleted uranium, which absorbs spared neutrons at the start of the reaction, becoming U-239. Within minutes, the U-239 decays into neptunium-239, which decays once more into plutonium-239. And it's here that the burn and breed process starts to come full circle. Plutonium-239 is an incredibly energy-rich element, which is why it's the favored isotope for nuclear weapons. But according to TerraPower's president and CEO Chris Levesque, using the TWR to produce plutonium-239 doesn't create the danger of nuclear proliferation. He says it's just the opposite. Instead of accumulating in the reactor, stray neutrons will split the plutonium into a shower of various elements, and best of all, they can be reused almost immediately as more fuel, just as Feinberg had predicted over half a century ago. The best part about the way these TWRs use fuel could potentially solve one of the most daunting issues facing nuclear power, that pesky nuclear waste. But because these plants began with depleted fuel and then utilized that fuel more efficiently than other counterparts, TerraPower says we could see a massive reduction in nuclear waste. According to the company, a 1200 megawatt reactor will only generate roughly 5 metric tons of waste per gigawatt hour per year, which may sound like a lot, but it's nothing compared to the 21 metric tons per gigawatt hour per year that typical reactors produce today. This could have a far-reaching positive impact on the environment, as it could help reduce the amount of uranium needed to be mined and processed in the first place, while also leaving a much smaller nuclear footprint in the future. It will still take some time to get the project fully up and running. Right now, the initial plans will cost roughly $4 billion. But if the plant proves successful, TerraPower hopes to drop these costs by $1 billion in future projects. So, is TerraPower's TWR the answer to loads of clean energy too cheap to meter? Well, time will tell. But as always, some people are less optimistic. One of those naysayers is Arjun Mekjani, president of the Institute of Energy and Environmental Research, a U.S.-based anti-nuclear organization. According to him, one of the biggest hurdles TerraPower's reactor will face is achieving its potential energy capacity. He points specifically to two similar reactor types in France and Japan. The former, the Super Phoenix, could barely reach 7% capacity during its 10-year run, largely due to sodium leaking into the fuel storage tank. More frightening, Manju in Japan shut down after less than a year when vibrations in the liquid sodium ruptured a pipe, causing a massive fire. One major safety concern for molten salt reactors is that the sodium sludge is both violently flammable and extremely toxic. Yeah, I think that sodium is going to be a bigger challenge than they think, often being labeled the Achilles heel of these types of reactors. Still, TerraPower plans to move forward with its Wyoming-based project. After nearly a decade of research, the company is nearly ready to move out of the conceptual phase and into the engineering. Field activities in Kemmerer are scheduled to be completed in early July 2022, and early construction activities will likely begin in 2024. In the grand scheme of clean, renewable energy, fission may not be the final answer to life, the universe, and everything. But it could provide a major stopgap while wind, solar, and other emerging energy production and storage technology catch up. What we know is that the planet is nearing its own critical mass when it comes to climate. And while we don't want to become so desperate as we throw out caution completely to the wind, might we need to take some drastic measures before it's too late? That's kind of the question. Wait for the ideal solution or find stopgaps along the way? But what do you think? Are TWRs safe, clean, affordable ways to move forward with nuclear? Do you think wind and solar are enough at this point to take nuclear energy completely off the table altogether? Sound off in the comments below. If there's any exciting energy developments you want us to cover, of course, let us know. I'm Ricky Tuba Da Vinci, and we'll catch you guys next week.